tamer than you were, I think. You had a more wild image. Am I correct in thinking that?
Well, I think Elvis was a little bit more conservative than I was. He hid himself more, I would say, from the public than I did. I was more wide open than Elvis. I never hid anything. Yeah. Whatever I did, I never tried to hold it a secret.
There's one story that is, I read constantly about you, that you went to Graceland, you had a gun, the sheriff comes, takes you away. What is the truth behind that story, if there is any, but what happened?
Elvis, in the last days there, he was, about 15 times he called me on the phone, you know, and he said, "Jerry, I got to see you, it's very important, I'm very depressed and I want to talk to you, you know, and he talked to you bad." And I just couldn't visualize Elvis Presley being down and out, depressed about anything. And I shunned him off and I didn't go, you know. And one night he called me down at the Vapors Club there in Memphis, about a mile or so from his home. And it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. And to admit the truth about it, I was drinking a lot of champagne that night. I don't drink champagne. And it made me a little wild, you know.
A little bit.
And so, yeah, really. Yeah. And so, to say the least. So I went out and got my Lincoln car, you know. I said, "Well, I'm going to come down and see you, so I'll be there in a minute," you know. So I walked outside, and Mr. Ford, Charlie Ford, went on the Vapors. He said, "Jerry, just a minute, I have a present for you." And he gave me this .38 Dillinger pistol. It was brand new. Had never been fired. I still have it. Never has been fired. And I said, "Oh, thank you, Mr. Ford." And I went to put it in my glove compartment. He said, "No, put this on the dashboard. If you conceal it in your glove compartment, it's against the law, run you down, it's against the law. But if you put it on your dashboard and not conceal it, it's not against the law. Take it home." I said, "Okay, well, I forgot I was going by Elvis's house."
So you drove by with the gun out.
So I drove by, and the gun was there on the dashboard. Yeah. And when I turned into Elvis's house, it was front end of that Lincoln, like it was a mile long to me. And I misjudged it, and I run into his gate. And he had hired a new guard. Travis wasn't on the gate. Uncle. He had a new guard on the gate. So he come running out there, and I hit the gate, and it was shaking all over like he was doing a show on that, you know? And it was kind of funny to me, I don't know. And he said, "Well, what do you want?" I said, "Well, Elvis called me and wants to see me." He said, "Yeah, who are you?" I said, "Well, just tell him Jerry Lee's here, you know." And he saw that gun on the day before the car. And he ran back and he called the law. And so I'm sitting there, you know, and a minute later, the law about 5 or 6 squad cars surrounded my car, you know. I'm sitting there looking at it, and I was really loaded. And I went to put the seat back on the car, and instead of putting the seat back, I was putting the window down. And I didn't know it. I threw this champagne bottle out the window, and I thought it was down and knocked the whole window clean out. So they knew I was loaded. And it was embarrassing. And I said, "What are you going to do with that gun? You going to shoot Elvis Presley?" I said, "Well, if you're silly enough to think that," I said, "probably so."
And that's where it came.
And he said, "Get out of that car, the old kid." That was the deal on that. And Elvis waited and waited and waited on me.
Was there ever any competition between the two of you? Did you ever feel that I mean, you're both,
no,
you know, the leaders of a movement, almost a revolution.
We considered ourselves both kings of rock and roll, so to speak. Yeah. I mean, in our own way. He considered himself the number one artist. I did too. And the honest thing, I'd done what I wanted to do. Elvis, he wanted to do the things I did, but he was scared too. And he tried to do it and hide it. And so I said, "Elvis, you know, you ought to be your own man. Do what you want to do. Don't let these people tell you what to do." Well, Elvis Presley was a fine person. And I miss him very much. And he was one of my dear friends. Somebody I could depend on, yeah?
When you talk about, as you saw yourself as kids, you both saw yourself as kings, a question I was wanting to ask you is, when the history of rock and roll is written, where will your place be?
Well, I was the first artist inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Love me tender, love me sweet, never.
but no matter how silly, my pictures always made money. Paramount used it to make back for Peter O'Toole, Richard Burton. Why couldn't they spend it on making Richard with me? And the Colonel turned down dramatic roles because there was no music. You see, all the movie songs went through the Colonel, and they sucked like donkeys. The son of a bitch took 50% of everything from me. Then he shaked down the writers for 50% of their cut. The result was the best songwriter stayed away. And I got old-fashioned songs that didn't maintain my singing career. I couldn't burn manure in music, man. I tried to fight the Colonel, but I realized I'd have to finish up my movie contract to win back my audience.
Well, why did you stay with the Colonel?
I was a very loyal person. I was taught to obey and respect others, no matter what. And when I went to Germany, the Colonel worked hard to keep me as a star. Anyway, I wasn't concerned with the business of my career. You know, I was concerned with my fans and being the best I could be for them. A lot of entertainers can tempt their audience, but not me.
Did you like doing the fight scenes?
Oh, yeah. And there was fights in every picture. And I had learned karate in the Army. And it was new Hollywood at the time. Once, I even punched my horse. He wouldn't listen to me. Wouldn't stop. So I punched him in the head. And after that, we were friends. I liked the cowboy movies. I embossed some horses and rode up Graceland.